Viewer discretion is advised. June 18th, 2020. At approximately 8 p.m., a female junior high school student had left the train station in Nakano Ward of Tokyo. They walked home in the dead of night, alone. Breathing heavily from behind, a 29-year-old hooded cyclist quickly caught up to the teen. Without warning, the cyclist hopped off their bike, fondled the young girl's chest, and just as quickly as they came, disappeared into the night. In a country ravaged by undocumented sexual abuse, where within the past decade a third of the female population had publicly stated their own stories of sexual harassment, this innocent young girl had two choices. One, to remain silent like many before her, fearing the public decrying and shaming of her speaking out, further proving the low government statistics of documented sexual assault in Japan correct. Or two, become an outlier and immediately report the incident, hoping that Japan's legal system and its 99% conviction rate will bring her assailant to justice. Scared, shamed, and overwhelmed with emotion, she thought long and hard before deciding to report the incident to the local police precinct. What this young girl did not know, and what their investigators would later discover, is that on a nearby street, the perpetrator struck again. Similar action, similar circumstances, even similar age. The assailant came and went, speeding through the Tokyo streets on the same bicycle, presumably, never to be seen again. August 8th, 2020. The 29-year-old story writer for the then hit of Shonen Jump's catalog, Act Age, Tatsuya Matsuki, is arrested on suspicion of committing indecent acts on a minor. Both incidents that took place on the night of June 18th were linked directly to him, security camera footage confirming his appearance in Nakano Ward. When pressed by investigators about these accusations, Matsuki stated, "There's generally nothing incorrect about them." Shueisha, the publisher of the Jump line of magazines such as Shonen Jump, Young Jump, and Ultra Jump, would quickly go on damage control. Not only canceling Act Age in the middle of its run, its artist openly disavowing Matsuki despite his contributions to the work, but also ceasing all publications of Act Age tankobons worldwide. The rumored anime adaptation that would be announced that year was quickly scrapped behind the scenes, the stage adaptation of one of its arcs quickly canned in the months to come. Matsuki would never work for Jump or potentially in manga ever again. He would later be indicted and given a suspended sentence of 3 years, avoiding prison time due to good behavior. This is sadly the most firm punishment of a sexual abuser, specifically one targeting minors like Matsuki, Shueisha has ever taken. Even more than that, the only one that's seemingly stuck in the long term. Regardless of your opinion on the material of Act Age, its beautiful artwork and compelling narrative aside, its memory in the public consciousness is now tainted by its creator's actions. Separating art from artist is difficult for some people. While some choose to directly ignore the heinous actions of some creators due to their work not directly reflecting their person, others choose to turn that work into a direct critique of their creators and publishers. I choose to remember Act Age as it was, but cannot separate the actions of its creator from some key facts about it. 1. Its main potential relationship was set up between a girl in her teens and a man in his late 20s. 2. The manga being cancelled just around the time we meet a victim of the previously stated male lead's actions, on set and off. And 3. It is a work that directly comments on the entertainment industry and how it treats its talents, especially those of the female sex. Consider these points when looking at Act Age, as we dive further down the rabbit hole of the abusers within Jump, how the company itself decided to handle these scandals, its treatment of its talent, and the grander cultural implications these reflect upon Japan.
Sasuke, honto omae, Naruto card game wa atsumete daro. Tsukinkute
tsuyoku natsu.
Hikaru Dragon Bottle tsuki.
Eiichiro Oda is a superstar. Creator of the current longest-running series within Shonen Jump's pages, lasting over 2 decades in regular serialization, and spawning merely at the age of 20 a series that would go on to become a cultural juggernaut, Oda's talents were apparent even at an early age. In fact, his first submission to Shueisha, one he made in junior year of high school, mind you, would win second class at the annual Tezuka Awards.
This not only got him published, but also a cash prize of 500,000 yen, and a lot of industry connections. As a result, Oda became entrenched in the growing community of mangaka from his generation. He would develop deep and personal relationships with a lot of these young guns. Masashi Kishimoto, Hiroyuki Takei, Shinya Suzuki, and the focus of this particular portion, Mitsutoshi Shimabukuro. Shimabukuro was a big fan of Wanted as a fellow mangaka, and only being a year younger than his contemporary. While not making a major placement until the age of 19, Shimabukuro proved with his quirky and crude designs that he was a force to be reckoned with. His first manga to have serialization within Shonen Jump, Seiki Matsu Leader Den Takeshi, would release only a month before One Piece. This rivalry that the two would develop with each other would benefit both of their careers, each having won first place in readers' polls upon each series release. So, they motivated each other to do more. The weekly shonen manga crunch is, without question, one of the most physically taxing jobs an artist can have. You have to write, sketch, ink, and then later plan a whole separate issue of a comic, all in one week. Sitting at the same desk for hours on end, drawing stuff like this. And this. And this! It's simply too much for one person to do before burning out at some point. That's ignoring the bureaucracy of Jump editors and how brutal it is as a creator to even get your story serialized. So the fact that these two would both consistently win these polls, albeit somewhat irregularly for Shimabukuro compared to Oda, and both get anime adaptations for their first big foray into weekly serialization is a Herculean effort. And while One Piece would go on to shatter records left and right, only now going into irregular chapter releases due to Oda's work habits catching up with him, Takeshi would be cancelled after 5 years in 2002. The reason why for its cancellation, one could possibly surmise, was a result of this weekly grind. Keeping up a gag manga and keeping it fresh every week must have impacted the sales in some way, and as a result, was quietly cancelled while his peers continued marching on. Right? Let's talk about Japanese prostitution laws. In May of 1956, female members of the Japanese National Diet succeeded in lobbying for their prostitution prevention law, a long-fought victory for feminist groups and women all across the country. However, there was a small loophole left within the law, something possibly unintentional given its clearly stated rules. It only banned the soliciting and circulating of services providing, well, sex. Vaginal sex. This didn't prevent other forms of sexual interaction, such as oral, anal, and newer innovations in their culture, from being circulated through discreet business fronts. Soon, bathhouses would open, offering a fee for using their bathing facilities, as well as a separate fee for massage. You can see where this goes from here. And while soaplands, as they're called, have been actively pursued by law enforcement for being in direct violation of this law, most haven't. Businesses like these, such as hostess clubs and pink salons, offer different forms of physical interaction beyond the mission standard. Within recent years, the Japanese sex industry has reached into the upper hundred millions and hurtled toward $1 billion within the next decade. These businesses, as well as the Japanese adult video industry and compensated dating, thrive because of the clear demand. Sex work is viewed with historical and cultural significance in Japanese society, brothels being around as early as the 15th century in documented history. It was around during the Sengoku period, the Meiji era, the economic recession of the 90s, and still now. This is also ignoring the greater issue of human trafficking within Japan. Foreign women often physically and emotionally abused to be subservient to their employers, but also Japanese natives. These natives aren't just abused or emotionally troubled women despite the high child abuse rate within Japan. Rather, some come from relatively normal backgrounds. These potential employers act as recruiters on streets, saying they're modeling or talent agents to lure potential victims into dreams of grandeur. These women are trapped in contracts with contradictory rules, treated as less than human, and turned more into an object for which men can enact their deviant fantasies. And sadly, this also affects the youth population as well. Despite the standard age of consent being 13 years old, in reality it's only with people within a similar age range. The commonly acceptable age for intercourse is still the generalized age of 18 or older. This has not stopped sex traffickers from taking young girls anyways, or for young girls within Japan to take advantage of this dormant clientele. Which of course, brings us to Shimabukuro. On November 22nd of 2001, Shimabukuro met a 16-year-old girl at a love hotel in Yokohama. This girl had lied about her identity on an anonymous internet forum, and Shimabukuro himself seemed to not care in the moment, They gave the girl 80,000 yen, performed acts that were in direct violation with the prostitution prevention law, and was later arrested on August 7th the next year. Being a repeat offender, given his history of paying for adult services and claiming that he was unaware of her actual age, the story made headlines and Jump quickly went on the defensive. They quickly canceled leader Den Takeshi, as Shimabukuro was given a suspended sentence of 4 years. If he violated his parole, he would get 2 years jail time. This was the early 2000s. While this would make waves for a time, eventually things cooled down enough for Shimabukuro to debut in Jump once again. In 2004, Shimabukuro would quietly debut the fictional sport manga Ring, which would only run for 24 chapters before being cancelled. Shimabukuro would not fade into obscurity, though. Instead, in 2008, he would release his most widely remembered series in Jump, Toriko. Running from 2008 to 2016 and spread across 43 tankobons, Toriko matches Shimabukuro's wild humor with Jump's typical action-adventure formula to create a winning combination with a memorable main character. Toriko would even directly cross over with One Piece on numerous occasions, first starting with a one-shot co-produced by his close friend, Eiichiro Oda. More recently, Shimabukuro has ended his run on another short-lived series called Build King and Jump, proving how his efforts still bring consistent enough readership for Shueisha to keep him employed. It's somewhat dumbfounding for the Japanese government to pass such a ruling compared to the punishment given later to Tatsuya Matsuki, but that was not a result of hubris. Rather, it's consistency, built into Japan's patriarchal society, and while Shimabukuro and Oda would remain good friends into the future, a year after Toriko's end, another associate of the two would be under fire for something we could argue is much, much worse.
Kenshin Himura walks the path of death and destruction, ushering in a new regime.
At one point in his career, Oda was an assistant alongside mangaka Hiroyuki Takei on an ongoing shonen manga. One of particular note during the 90s is the two prepared their own material for pitching. Rurouni Kenshin was created by Nobuhiro Watsuki, a mangaka active earlier than Oda and Shimabukuro's generation, but walked along a similar path of contests and bolstering resumes. After working on three separate samurai one-shot manga, he would eventually stir together the best ideas from each into Rurouni Kenshin. During its run, Watsuki would give Oda opportunities to hone his craft, mentoring him as he was still formulating what would inevitably become One Piece. And as this happened, Kenshin would begin to sell gangbusters, upwards of 70 million copies in circulation worldwide. Kenshin would go on to receive three sequel manga, a TV anime, several OVAs, appearances alongside Oda's characters and Shimabukuro's in Jump crossover games, and films both animated and live action. Kenshin itself has spawned a million-dollar franchise, one that's still lucrative in foreign markets given the recent announcement of a new adaptation by Leiden Films. And while it seems like Watsuki as a creator will never stop working in this industry, there was indeed a point in his career where that was called into question. And to explain why, let's talk about pornography law within Japan. In the year 2014, the production and possession of CP was finally outlawed in Japan, almost a decade and a half later than the United States. And while this was a clear victory over Japan's underground sex industry and the trafficking of minors therein, there was another problem still poised by its phrasing. The doujin market. Or more specifically, hentai. Hentai, of course, meaning anything sexually charged or graphic imagery that could be published in doujin circles at conventions or specialty stores. Some famous doujins, especially ones featuring original characters separate from any pre-existing franchise, even got animated productions by studios like Pink Pineapple and Queen Bee as early as the late 80s. I think it should be said that not all doujinshi feature explicit material or sexual situations. Rather, they're a way for up-and-coming artists, writers, and programmers to create work together they wouldn't be able to publish through traditional means. However, the adult content that comes from these circles have been scrutinized on the national stage, even getting the attention of the UN for their incredibly graphic depictions of sexual violence. Urged in 2015 to essentially go all the way with their banning of child pornography, both real and fictionalized, the Japanese government initially fired back at the sentiment, its ruling traditionalist party claiming it was well within the artist's rights for freedom of expression. Half a decade later, when the Japanese Communist Party, originally deemed an advocate for free speech and freedom of expression, proposed further restrictions on depictions of child abuse within media, the party came under fire and tons of social media protest. Police statistics dating back to the year 2000 argue that reported crimes of child abuse had increased tenfold, coinciding with the doujin market's own growth. Other studies stating that the increased access to such materials could result in further normalizing child abuse within the country, something that's been on the rise for some time. The US Supreme Court had acknowledged this in their own ban on CP, but had stated there was only circumstantial evidence supporting the claim. And while more and more statistics were brought up during this debate, how material like this could even be used to groom children for such abuse, Shonen Jump's own history was called into question. From 1968 to 1972, legendary mangaka Go Nagai worked on Harenshi Gakuen, something considered to help pioneer the ecchi subgenre for manga, one that took place within a modern elementary school. Published within Jump, it was subject to controversy from parent-teacher associations across the country, despite the manga itself not showing explicitly sexual situations involving the students, merely gags at their expense. The manga was a raging success, reaching over 1 million copies in circulation, but Nagai became demonized in Japanese society for producing such a work in the first place. So, in direct protest to these PTA groups, Nagai went the meta route and turned Harenshi Gakuen into a bloody mature manga by its end. Nagai actively argued through the children's perspective the freedom of expression he felt he was denied, and those children were killed by the PTA for standing in opposition. While the series would return in the 90s and even get multiple anime and film adaptations, the point was made just as clear decades ago as it was on Twitter decades later. A major reason why sexual depictions of children, whether for comedy or otherwise, is still legal within Japan is due to mangaka like Ken Akamatsu, a man famous for depicting his teen protagonists in such sexual situations, being on Japan's House of Counselors in order to continue fighting for this freedom of expression. While Jump would again fall under controversy for similar reasons as Harenshi Gakuen in 2019, Watsuki would come under fire for a much greater offense. In February of 2018, Watsuki, aged 47, would be indicted for possession of CP, a police investigation revealing it being readily available at both his place of work and home computer. He would only be fined 200,000 yen, roughly 1,900 American dollars, and received zero jail time. Sure, the spin-off Rurouni Kenshin Hokkaido arc manga was placed on hiatus for a period and Watsuki was lambasted by the public, that was it. Watsuki would return to finish the Hokkaido arc 6 months after it was put on hiatus, finish its run, and continue to exist in the industry unopposed. Creators within Jump, seemingly indifferent to the conflict publicly, still respect Watsuki enough to speak his praises and tribute him in official Jump material. A man that has gone on record saying he liked girls in late elementary school to around the second year of middle school. Being a company with zero female editors, despite a history of female mangaka selling well within the company, those in charge of the Jump line seemed to be stuck in a boys' club of sorts. When a head editor within Jump was pressed on this, they stated they would hire a female editor so long as they understood the heart of a young boy. I think that quote summarizes Jump's managerial staff as a whole. A place focused on the things they loved as children, expressing those values to a new generation, and hopefully making consistent enough sales to justify its existence. That's not to say the stories within Jump are all terrible, and that Jump itself has never contributed to the cultural lexicon of the modern day. Rather, there are select individuals within Jump's higher management that are really only caring about it as a business, allowing those who abuse its country's very laws, a place where women often abstain from reporting the rampant sexual harassment they face on a day-to-day basis, a place where a father can walk away from his own sexual abuse of their daughter and walk away scot-free, to still make money. People often bring up this statistic about Demon Slayer outselling the entire modern Western comics industry, and I think there is some merit to this. It means that manga is much more popular outside of its target audience, that being the country of Japan. The name Shonen Jump summons up thousands of characters and stories, iconography that are now standing alongside superheroes as popular merchandising opportunities. And while Tatsuya Matsuki was punished and quietly blacklisted from the industry, the artist of Act Age, Shiro Uzuzuki, was left to pick up the pieces and get back to pitching again. She has yet to have a solid ongoing as of the time of this video, which is a damn shame, because Shiro Uzuzuki's art is wonderful. Her full page spreads, intense expressions, excellent paneling, she brought Act Age to life in the best way. It stood out in the magazine because the story had these incredible visuals and well-designed characters. As interesting as Act Age was as just a concept, Usazuki made what would have been a mediocre battle shonen at best into something that mesmerized readers, one that became the next big thing in Jump. And as so long as people like her get to work in Jump, so long as creators like Gigi Akutami or Koyohayo Gotouge are top sellers, so long as people like Matsuki are held accountable unlike his forebearers, there might be a change coming within Jump. All I can hope is that that change comes soon. We really do need it. Thank you for watching.